Well, folks, today it's Sunday, it's raining, it's wet, it's miserable. But as you can see, I'm cozy inside, sales down below on the computer. And today I'm going to talk about your safety. A very complicated subject, I know. There's many professionals that will give you advice and listen to them, especially people from the RNLI. Because they're the guys that come out in all weathers and risk their lives to save yours. Hopefully, if this information helps you and you get it right, you can help them to help you and help yourself. So what I'm going to start with is how much do you value your life? If somebody came along and said, "Well, I want your life, how much?" You'd say millions. But if somebody came along and said to you, "How much you spend on safety gear on the boat?" I know because I've heard many people say it. "Oh, you know, I've got a flare pack and I've got a VHF radio, I've got a life jacket." Yeah? When was the last time you checked any of it? Where is it? Can you grab it quick? If it all turned to nasties, how fast do you think your boat would sink? Well, somebody keep trying to call me, sorry about that. Well, the basics are, on a survey done by the United States Coast Guard, they found that predominantly yachts, and I'm covering yachts for sailing people, yachts go down by the head. For other words, they go down bow first. Because usually a yacht has struck something and torn a hole in the bow or ripped the keel off, the boat fills up and down she goes. So I'm going to cover this as that case scenario. Now, why I'm doing this is I'm doing this mainly for coastal sailors because ocean sailors are pretty geared up people. When you've got the experience to sail around the world, they've usually got it sorted out. So there's many items I'm going to name on here. I have no association with any companies I'm going to mention. It's just companies that I know and companies that I've dealt with. Now, a lot of the safety equipment on here can be got from a company called oceansafety.co.uk. They are professionals in what they do. They supply to the leisure market, they also supply to the commercial market. So that says a lot about them because commercial people who are interested in safety is for two reasons. One, they don't want their people hurt. They don't want their people to die. And two, it costs them a lot in litigation if they do. Saying that, as I say, I have nothing to do with the company, but I do know of it and I know their products that they sell. So let's have a look at how far you're going to go. So what you're going to do? There's a nice little marina, Brixham. Yeah, so you're going to pop out of there just 2 or 3 miles off the coast and pop down the coast for a day, find somewhere to moor up, anchor up, have a bit of lunch. If it's nice weather, perhaps have a swim and come back for the evening. Not far. Don't need much for that, do you? Don't you? Let's look at a really worst case scenario. Any meteorologist will tell you that weather fronts can come in really quick. Sally and I were sailing once from Pirasgirac to Guernsey. Pirasgirac is on the north coast of Brittany. We had a junk rig on our 24-foot, 6-ton Falmouth Pilot, set off with full sail. The forecast was for a 5, northwesterly, lovely, that'll do, headed out. Within 2 hours, we were in 62 knots of wind and 20-foot seas coming from the southwest. And the ship really did hit the fan because the top block on our sail broke and I couldn't reef it. Now the beauty with a junk sail, you can just let it fly so that it's minimum power. Unfortunately, I had to sit in the cockpit for 9 hours and Sully literally had to feed me. I couldn't leave the helm. I had no pilot, no nothing. And in those days, we had a small life raft. We didn't have much of a grab bag. We didn't have a lot of money. But because we knew what we were doing and we'd planned together, we got to Guernsey perfectly safely. Now, I know the arguments. People are going to say it's expensive to buy this equipment. Yes, it is. It's expensive to buy a car. But you insure your car, don't you? Got a jack, got a spare wheel, got a brace to undo it. You got your gilet, your yellow jacket, got your triangle and all that. That's for your safety. Because you don't want to get rammed if you have a breakdown or a puncture and you're stopped on the motorway. I'm going to forewarn them. So this is what I'm going to do with you. I'm going to forewarn you. You could leave anywhere, South Coast, French Coast, anywhere you like, and think you're going out in good weather. You listen to the weather forecast. And this is a classic example. The forecast for today here was brilliant sunshine. So it shows you how wrong that is. So I'm going to prepare you so that hopefully this never happens. This is money I hope you waste, to be honest. It's like a lifeboat. £3 million for a lifeboat. And there's nothing to give me greater happiness than to see it rot on its moorings and never go out. That'd be great. £3 million well wasted, trust me. So let's start on what you need. Now, first thing we're going to go in is to your life raft. When you look at your boat, when you go down to your boat, whether you're sailing with your wife, friends or whatever, make sure that your wife and your friend are as knowledgeable as you are about the boat. Perhaps they've never been down before, never been sailing before. This is common sense. Look at your life raft. Now, most life rafts are on a cage, if you've got them on the back of the boat, hopefully on the back. And in the cage, it has a long pin and there's a little cotter pin in the end. It also has a larger hole for putting a padlock. Story one. Went on a chap's boat the other day before I did this. I'd look and I said to him, I see you've locked your life raft on your boat. Oh yeah, I always lock it. He said, people pinch them. Ah, I said, right. I said, can I just have a look at your release mechanism? Yep, okay, he says. So he said, gone for about 5 minutes. Sorry, I can't find the key. There you go, you got a life raft on your boat, you can't launch. When he did find the key, the padlock was so rusty it wouldn't open it. I had to use axle to get it off. If you're going to buy a padlock, buy a brass one. Make sure it's sprayed with a good WD-40, something like that. And make sure you know where the key is on you. Before you set off to sea, unlock your life raft. Make sure that little pin comes out so the big pin can be drawn and it launches. Also, you have a rope that comes from inside the life raft, which is about 10 meters long. Now this rope is attached to your boat for a very good reason. That when you launch the life raft is then 10 meters away attached to your boat. You pull this line hard and the life raft inflates. That's the purpose of the line. The problem is, where do you attach the line? I have just been told by somebody who saw the line on their life raft attached to a boat they've just bought, and if they pulled it, it would have just come off. So goodbye, life raft. Hope you can swim a long way or stay afloat a long time. So make sure it's anchored somewhere really sound. Now, your cockpit railings, otherwise known as your push bit, have good sound bases. You also have the U-bolts that hold your rigging. Tie it with a bowline. Good and tight. Take one turn and then do the bowline. Then the tail in the bowline, the little spare tail you see, stitch that to make sure it can't come undone. So you're safe there. So that's your life raft. Now, take the person below. They know how to launch the life raft. They've got their life jacket on. What do you have on a life jacket? Now, I don't say that everybody can afford this and everybody should have one. Personally, I think they should. But a PLB, personal location beacon. Now, these things go for around £100. They work on a 406 system, which means it sends it when you activate it, it sends a signal to a satellite, which then sends it down to, normally I think it's Falmouth, the main rescue centre, notifies them of your position and your distress. So they know that it's all turned pear-shaped and they will contact the nearest authorities to come and help you or boats in the area. There's one other thing I didn't put in my last piece, which I'll put in here. There is a new item come out today. It's called AIS, Automatic Identification System. Now, there are two. A very good friend of mine, Claude Van Martin, which you can find on the net, very, very knowledgeable guy, really nice. If you want help, he's done all sorts. He has an AIS system that emits a signal. So, for other words, any other vessels with AIS can see exactly where he is. I actually follow him when he's sailing on my phone. I have an app that follows him. You can also get a VHF radio with AIS receiver only. Now, what this does is every commercial vessel over 300 feet, and now a lot of yachts, transmit on their AIS transmitter a little signal. And what it does, it tells you who the vessel is, what size it is, what speed and course it's doing. It tells you all about it. So you can look on your AIS on the picture screen, on your radio, or you can have it on your chart plotter, and it shows you where all these boats are going. It also tells you if that boat's on a collision course with you. That's helpful. But the important thing is this little AIS transponder. It's a personal one. Hook it to your life vest. If in a case of emergency, you fall off the boat. No, never fall off? Oh, right, okay. So you fall off, this thing sends a signal to your boat, to your AIS, saying you've gone, an alarm sounds. The person who's on the boat looks at the AIS and says, blimey, there's my crew. Down come the sails, spin her around, start the motor, start heading back. Now the guy who's fallen off, if he's sensible, has not only got his AIS or his PRB on him, he's got a waterproof VHF. Now the reason is, let's say it's at night and it's a bit rough. The guy on the boat won't see you in the water, even with a flashing light. You have to be pretty close, but you can see the masthead light from a long way off. So he now knows where you are and he's going to turn around and approach you. Now you don't want to get run down by your yacht. And your mate's probably not too experienced. So get on a VHF and talk to him. Right, this is what I want you to do. Once he's heading towards you, because you've already explained if ever you go overboard, this is how he goes back to the spot, so he knows all that and he's heading back to you. You'll see him before he sees you. So start giving him guidance. Once you see the cross trees, tell him, drop the speed to a knot. When he's coming closer and closer to you, tell him which side you want him to go down. Tell him to turn port or starboard 1 degree, 2 degrees, until you get alongside the boat and you can say, I'm here! And grab on. Or he throws a life sling and you grab onto the life sling. Well, you haven't got one of those. Oh, well, okay. Perhaps he'll grab on his own. You see how it goes? All the little things that can go wrong. Can't get him back, you can't get him on. Now I'm going to cover this in another video about man overboard. And when I do it, I'm going to show you such a way that you won't believe how easy it is to get someone on board and how cheap. My wife Sally is 4'8" tall, 4'10" tall. She's only a midget, little Martian. Me, I'm a lot taller. I'm 5'8" and around 75 kilos. Now we practice this once a year. Every year we've got it down pat, and we used it recently when we hit something at sea and damaged the boat. It's a simple system where Sally can lift me and the dinghy out the water. I'll get into that in another video. I digress. So now we're going to start talking about what equipment you want on the boat. So again, it's like anchors. Nobody wants to spend a fortune on an anchor, but they'll spend a fortune on insurance. When a storm blows up, the insurance won't hold you to the bottom, but an anchor will. So this is what I would recommend that you carry. Now, there are very good grab bags. Very good. I can't say anything against them. They're manufactured especially for the job. They float, they do all sorts of things. But my biggest problem I have with understanding grab bags is I have been on many yachts, and when you ask to have a look at their grab bag, it's under a ton of gear in the cockpit locker, or it's somewhere in a berth that's below where you have to go below to get it. Be prepared, Scout's motto. Your life raft should be on the aftmost rail. It can be on the side of the push bit, doesn't matter. The other side, you need a barrel. Now they come in sizes from 15 litres to 60 litres. You can get really big ones. A friend of mine just here has got one. And you attach that to your rail. On that, you have a line, which is attached to a 10 litre jerry can of water. Now the first thing you do when you get on your boat is you fill that with fresh water. Only 8 litres. If you only put 80%, 20% will keep the can afloat. Not finished. Tie a line to it, fasten it to your barrel, put a float on it. It doesn't need a big one, just a little 10 inch fender will float it. You've got a spare fender on the boat for sure. When the ass is grass and you launch the life rope, cut the line, ditch them. They'll float. If you've got them attached to the life raft like we do, the whole lot floats off together. So you've got a barrel with your emergency equipment. You've got 8 litres of drinking water. You're in your life raft and you've got some comforts. Because believe me, I've been sailing for 65 years and the only time I was ever sick was in a life raft. And that was in the North Sea, not pleasant. So, just a drop of tea before I start coughing. What should we have in this barrel? Okay, this is a list I prepared earlier. So, first thing we'll have in there is a torch. Now, we have a wind-up torch in ours because they take no batteries. They're not difficult to use. You wind them for a minute, you get 10 minutes light. They're pretty bright, not marvellous. Today, you have LED torches, which give out enormous light for using very little consumption of batteries. The choice is yours. If you're going to go for battery-powered torches, get the ones with this light. Just excuse. Now, if you see that yellow strip, I'm not going to put it on because it will blind you. It is that bright. In fact, this is the main torch. So that's quite a bright torch. It's difficult to see on the video. Now, when you get the second one, that is enormously bright. Trust me, in my cabin area here, I can put this on. You can see everywhere in the cabin. Now, that's a bit long. It's a bit big for putting in your bag. But you can get them literally that length. And they have that LED strip. The consumption is very, very small. Very small. Carry a spare pack of batteries. Personally, if it's AAA or AA, I prefer lithium batteries. And the reason for that is you can store lithium batteries for years. They don't worry about cold. The colder it gets, they work just fine. There are other makes, I presume, but I prefer lithium. I trust them. I know they work well. So that's your torch. Another thing you need is a survival knife. Now, a survival knife is specially made for a life raft because it has a round end. It hasn't got a point. The last thing you want in a life raft is something pointed. So I hope if your wife has jumped off, she's taken her stilettos off. Don't want a point. So a survival knife is important. Next thing, we've all got them. Everybody has got old CDs. Grab two of them. Stick them in your drum. If it's a sunny day, and for some reason your flares haven't worked, you haven't had the right flares, you've got pyrotechnic flares, you've used them up, and still nothing, and you see a boat on the horizon, get the boat through the hole in the centre of the CD, and then move the disc so that the sun reflects on the disc, and the person on the boat stands a good chance of seeing that because it's a very bright light from a CD disc when it reflects. If you ever notice, if you have them, I actually had a laugh. I have them on the boat to keep the birds off. And a friend of mine down in town, which is a kilometre away in the marina, said to me, "Oh, we thought the ambulance was down at your place." I said, "Why is that?" He said, "We are these red, yellow, blue, white lights flashing. It was my CDs. And it's just with ambient light from the street lights. Two CDs. Next thing is flares. There's going to be an argument on this, I know. Pyrotechnics, very good. The problem with pyrotechnics is You're in a rubber boat, and rubber burns. If you've never used a flare, if you've never been on a course, say an RYA course or something, and actually fired flares off, you don't realise how bad they can be. I have seen major burns with flares. Personally, I prefer an Odeo flare. I'll show you. This is a Mark II Odeo flare. Believe it or not, this is visible for 9 miles. It's actually visible more. We've tested this. I ran it up the top of the mast with friends on a dark night, and they could see me a lot more than 9 miles away. It has two functions. The LEDs at the top, LEDs at the side. This has a random function, so it flashes. It also has an SOS, Save Our Souls. 3 dots, 3 dashes, 3 dots. This is so people will know that it's a distress flare. Now, when you fire this off, I'll show you how simple. No fire involved. In fact, I'm going to undo this. Hope you're enjoying this. Right. This is my batteries. They are industrial lithium batteries. Okay, now you have three, and they go in this way. The flat end in, one, flat end in, two, flat end in, three. I bet I got on the wrong way around. Screw cap on the end, see the two rubber seals? So it's 100% watertight. Now, if I've got this right, the flare is going to go off, so mind your eyes. All you do is you just twist the bottom. And I've got the batteries the wrong way around. Oh, I love making videos. Right, okay. Let's try that again. All you do to switch this flare on and off is just unscrew half a turn. The first seal is already there, so we turn this. Now it's going to go on this time. Right, here we go. Now you can actually see it. This is the flare with its random. Here is the SOS. Oh. Three fast, three long, three fast. SOS. All you do, twist the bottom, it's off. That's all you have to do. Lanyard. I understand they make a smaller one now. It's about that long. I was looking at Ocean Safety's the other day about one, and I'm talking to a friend of mine on the net. And he's just bought a small one that you can actually attach to your life jacket. Very, very good idea to have that attached. I know life jackets have lights, but they're not that bright. So there's your Odeo flare. You should have one of those on the boat and in your drum. Next thing you want, if you go over, oh, here's my goose knocking on the boat for lunch. You'll have to wait. If you go over, it could be summer, it could be winter, but even in the summer, if you have to go overboard and get in your life raft, sometimes you can't step into the life raft, you might have to get off really quick. So you get on your wet. So here's a few things I think would help you greatly. Space blankets. They're very thin, they look like foil, they're easy to carry, they're only this, three make up the size of a fag packet. Wrap them around you and they stop you losing heat, body heat. Microfiber towel, you can pack them up the size of a fag packet again. A couple of those, they'll dry you off really quick and they dry quick. I've got something else down here. Sponge, you need a sponge in the boat because a life raft because it will get water in it from you. So you get one of these hydrated sponges, you buy them, they're very thin, look like a piece of plastic, but all you do is you put them in water and whoop, they blow up like a big car sponge. Another thing, a buoyant smoke flare. These again you can buy from that company, Ocean Safety. A smoke flare, where it's handy, is on very, very bright days. Pyrotechnics are not always easy to see, believe it or not. So what you want to do is make yourself visible like my wife's going to do now and feed the goose before I kill it. You want yourself to be visible. When you let a smoke flare off, it's an enormous cloud of orange smoke, which is visible for miles. So, and they float, so just carry one of those. You need a plastic cup, because you've got to drink the water. You need a teaspoon. What for? Ah, just a sec. So with a teaspoon, you can have something to eat. I carry 10 Mars bars and a jar of peanut butter in my drum. And why I carry this, and also a packet of ginger nuts. And why I carry this is I'm diabetic, so I can't eat ginger nuts and sweets, but I can have peanut butter, so it keeps energy. Sally can have the Mars bars. In the emergency, if I felt really sick, I could take a couple of ginger nuts, which stops it. Okay, we covered that little piece. The other thing I just wanted to mention was glow sticks. Marvellous invention. You take hold of a glow stick, snap it, shake it, and it lights for 12 hours. I personally carry white ones and red ones. You can put them on a small lanyard, hence the ball of string, fly it around your head, very visible. You can also use the white ones instead of burning the torch, and you can use those for reading. Handheld VHF should have been on your life jacket while you were on the helm. Waterproof notebook and pencil. You may receive messages over the VHF that you need to remember, and in an emergency situation, you don't always think straight, so write it down. The other thing is, like me, do you wear these things? Damn nuisance. I've knocked these off, well, not these, so many times it's unreal. These are actually made so that the arms actually swing out so they don't knock off. I have a spare pair of prescription glasses in our container. I also have two pairs of sunglasses, one for me, one for Sally. So you've got your water, you've got your food. Another thing, covered in salt. Worst thing for burns. So you take a pack of baby wet wipes. They're usually 70 lingettes, or 70 little cloths in there. They're nice and humid, they smell nice. If they're good enough for a baby's ass, they're good enough for your face. Have a little wash down with that to get the salt off of you, then dry yourself with your towel before you dry yourself with the towel. Otherwise you'll put the salt in the towel. The other thing is you want a first aid kit. Now first aid kits are very complicated things to talk about. As I said, my wife has a heart complaint. I also get gout, believe it or not, and I'm diabetic. It goes on as you get older. So I have to have medication every day, and so does she. So in our life thing, in our life bag, we carry the medications that we need with our spare glasses. Also, we carry Stugron seasickness tablets, which you can buy from the chemist, and I have found them to be the best. They were actually developed for the Navy. Another little thing is Dyrolite sachets. Now, Dyrolite sachets are a very, very wonderful little thing. They look like the size of a condom. Yep, the size of a condom packet. And inside there is magic. When you, in an emergency situation, your body goes through a shock. And when you suffer from shock, you lose fluids. As any medic will tell you, when people are shot or have an accident, the first thing they want to do is get fluids into them so the heart doesn't get overstressed. Now, Dyrolite is a mixture of salts and sugars. And what it does is it replaces the natural elements in your body, because your body is 70% water. So just drinking water won't necessarily keep you going. Remember this, the human body can go 30 odd days without food, but it can't go more than 5 days without water, because you start renal failure. So the water's important. Don't forget your 8 litres in your can. The Dyrolite sachets, you just put one in half a cup of water, down it goes, gets into your body, rejuvenates things, you start to think a bit better, things are a bit clearer, you're not panicking quite so much because you can concentrate and think. Very important. They're not expensive. Tin of Zambuk. Now, I'm going to ask my wife, she just go and get it for me, actually, so I can show you. Zambuk is something that was developed by the Africans hundreds of years ago as a natural antiseptic. There is a problem you can get if you're fishing near coral reefs and you get a poison from the hooks from the fish. Thank you, lovey. There you go, that's the stuff. Zambuk. Okay. You want to buy that? Boots keeps it, I believe, and you can also get it on Amazon from Rose Company. I actually used this on a bullet wound on somebody, and when the person got back to a hospital, the doctor said he'd never seen anything that had stopped infection in a wound as fast as that had. That's all I want to say about that, really. But you can put it, if you have a serious cut, you can literally pack the cut with it. Trust me, you can pack the cut. Won't hurt you, doesn't sting. You have nasal problems, you have sinusitis, anything like that, a little bit on your finger in the nostrils, very, very good. Do not take it internally. You mustn't eat it. Mustn't put it inside your mouth. Don't put it on your lips. Mosquito bites, sores, grazes, cuts, scratches, brilliant stuff. Little tin like that, couple of quid. I wouldn't be without it. The other thing is sunscreen. Yeah, I know. Summertime, we've got a lovely tan. Stick the oil on, let's get it. In an emergency situation, your life raft has a cover. Maybe your life raft didn't launch because it's old and it wasn't serviced, so you're in your dinghy. So you're out in the sun. Forgot your hat. Sun factor 50. You don't want cancer either. Little chopping board, about 15 by 20 centimetres. You can cut your Mars bars in half. Sounds silly. You might need to cut some plaster. You use cutting a piece of plaster. How many times have you seen people do this? They put the plaster on. Use a knife, because I haven't got scissors. Oh, look, I've cut my finger again. Clever, eh? That's where your first aid kit comes in handy, because it comes with scissors. Here's a little one for those who are going further off field. I like to keep a slight bright side, not to be too miserable. There's a thing called a solar steel. Can't order for thousands of pounds for water makers, but there's a thing called a solar steel. And this is a military idea that I know works. You carry 6 condoms. Please don't be offended, ladies. You carry 6 condoms and 6 socks. When you get the water in your solar steel, put it in the condom. When it's in the condom, put the condom in a sock, hang it up. Doesn't get cut, doesn't burst, and it holds a litre. Trust me, I know. And if you're right for water, and you're with your wife, enjoy yourselves without the problems of children coming. Now, I hope you've enjoyed this video. I've tried to put it as plainly as I can, but this is only the second time I've ever done this. So please bear with me. And hopefully when the weather gets better, I'll do this man overboard recovery system. Only at the moment I can't do it. It's too cold and a bit too risky around here. So speak to you later. If you like the video, let me know. If there's something more you want to know, let me know. I'm on WhatsApp, I'm on YouTube, and you can get me at allaboutboats.co.uk. Thanks for watching. Bye for now.